chapter 1 verse 28. Okay, so before that he's just saying that God, you know, he willed, it's his desire that to make known the riches of the his glory of his mystery among the Gentiles, you know, among not only among the Jewish people but also among the non-Jewish people. And and what is this mystery? That is Christ in you, the hope of glory, right? Or Christ living in us, and that's the hope of glory. We have us having the indwelling presence of the Lord, you know, the hope of glory in many various ways, where we see that you know, he who is in us is greater than he that is in the world. So in that sense, we are victorious, we are overcomers. He also leads us in a triumphant procession in Christ, and because the Holy Spirit is in us as a guarantee, which means that's pointing to something that is going to happen, a future event where the redemption will be complete. So in all these ways, you know, the mystery of the indwelling Christ, right, that the Christ in us is really the hope of glory. Okay, so verse 28 says, him we preached, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Okay, so who, him we preach. So whatever Paul was preaching was the content was Christ, right? So Christ is whom he preaches. He talks about warning every man, warning every person, which means you know, alerting, cautioning every person, and even gently reprimanding. Okay, that is what that word means, even a gentle reproof or reprimand. So warning every man and teaching, which means instructing, you know, doing the carrying out the work of a teacher, teaching every man in all wisdom, right? To for what end, right? What is the objective? You know, to be able to do this, right? To be doing this, that we may present every man perfect in Christ. So this was the objective, to minister in such a manner, to warn, to teach, to present every man perfect in Christ. And the word perfect means mature, you know, teleios. To present every person perfect, mature in Christ. To bring, in other words, to bring every person to maturity, right? So that there's nothing wanting, there's nothing lacking, to bring every person to that place of maturity in Christ Jesus. So so this is what he says, you know, we preach Christ with this objective in mind. We wanted to present him, present Christ to every person, warning, teaching, so that we might present every person perfect in Christ. Okay, so to this end, to achieve this, verse 29, I also labor, striving according to his working, which works in me mightily. So to, in order to do this, I labor. Now, in order to do this, I work. So the word labor, of course, means, you know, hard work, or physical hard work. There is toil, there is effort, there is every you know, what should I say, the side effect of that is that, well, the body becomes tired, there is toil, there is you know, fatigue, right? You become weary. That is the other side of it. So but he's saying, you know, to do this I labor, you know, which means I put in this kind of effort and I labor, striving according to his working. Okay, and the word striving, literally, you know, it means to compete for a prize. Okay, to struggle, to compete for a prize, to actually to like get into a contest and, you know, to press on and saying, okay, you know, that intensity, right? And the Greek word, you know, agonizomai, which means to really to go and compete and contend. You know, there's a lot of contending. There's a lot of contending with adversaries and all that. So he's saying, you know, I also labor striving according to his working. Okay, so there is this working in me. He is working in me. According to his working, I strive, or I put in this effort, right? I compete it's not obviously competing with other believers, but it's like an athlete who is competing to run the race. So in all form of readiness of physical, mental readiness and capability, and you know, he's preparing and he's putting in all that effort according to his working. So he's talking about the work of God in man, and he's saying, you know, God is working in me, the Holy Spirit is operating in me, and according to his working, in line with his working, I am striving, right? I'm doing this, and I'm laboring, right, in order to present every man perfect in Christ, right? According to his working, which works in me mightily, says, which mightily works in me. And the word there again is dunamis. We've been looking at that term over and over again, right? Strengthened with all might according to his glorious power. Verse 11, same thing, that you may be strengthened with his supernatural, wonder-working, miraculous power. Okay, so the same thing here, saying that, you know, his Holy Spirit power, his power works in me in this manner, works in me in this supernatural manner, in this wonder-working, miraculous, supernatural way. His power works in me. And according to his working, to this working, I strive, right? I work, I compete in a sense, and I do this so that I might present every man perfect in Christ. Okay, so really wonderful to see that, though. It's not like he's just totally taking it easy, very relaxed. No, he's doing it with a sense of urgency, a sense of a sense of commitment, a sense of I need to do this. I need to do this well, because the Spirit of God is working in me, and he is working in me effectively. He's working powerfully in me. In line with that, you know, his work is powerful in me, in my spirit. So in line with that, how can I, it's almost like, you know, how can I just take it easy, right? He's working in me, so I need to just press forward, press on, and get this done. Okay, so that's chapter one. Let's move on to chapter two. I'll just share the notes here. So chapter two. Let's just read through the few verses, and then we'll take time to go through it. Okay, for I want you to know what a great conflict I have for you and those in Laodicea. For as many as have not seen my face in the flesh, that their hearts may be encouraged, being knit together in love, and attaining to all riches of the full assurance of understanding, to the knowledge of the mystery of God, both of the Father and of Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Now this I say, lest anyone should deceive you with persuasive words. For though I am absent in the flesh, yet I am with you in spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ. As you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him and established in the faith, as you have been taught, abounding in it with thanksgiving. Beware lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit, according to the tradition of men, according to the basic principles of the world, and not according to Christ. For in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him, who is the head of all principality and power. Okay, so here Paul is talking about some of the things that he was going through personally. Right? He says, I want you to know what a great conflict I have for you and for those in Laodicea. So you know the Colossae and the neighboring area and the neighboring churches region. Laodicea is also there, and these are churches which didn't really where Paul didn't go physically. Right, he didn't go and meet with them, so they've not seen him face to face, but they've heard of him, and obviously Epaphras had ministered here in Colossae. So he's saying, I have a great conflict, in a sense, saying there's a, I care for your spiritual well-being, and at the same time there is this concern about things that are not right that are happening, that thing people who are teaching and preaching and spreading all kinds of different teachings. And so I have this concern, I have this great conflict inside of me, right? He's literally saying there's a great struggle, there's a great conflict, right? And what is it, right? He's saying that that their hearts may be encouraged, being knit together in love, attaining to all the riches of the full assurance of understanding, to the knowledge of the mystery of God, both of Father and Christ. So this is something that he's, again, saying that your hearts being knit together in love, that you've been grounded in love, rooted in love, that you may attain to the riches of the full assurance, that you may continue to, grow and reach that place of full assurance of understanding, reach that place of receiving the knowledge or growing in the knowledge of the mystery of God, both of the Father and of Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. So he's saying, make no mistake. Earlier on we saw, in Philippians, where Paul is saying that all the things that he's learned and, been trained for, and also everything about his background, his lineage, all things, he says, I consider them as garbage, as refuse, right? For the excellence of the knowledge of Christ, right? When I compare to that, I just put them aside and I say, it's nothing, right? Compared to the excellence of the knowledge of Christ. So here is saying, Christ, make no mistake that in Christ are hidden the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Okay, something for us to take note of. That, and this he says because next verse, we see that lest anyone should deceive you with persuasive words. And he goes on to explain later, but then, to the contrary. Okay, so in Christ, in the Father, Son, Spirit, in Christ are hidden the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. So if anyone should bring a teaching or teach anything to the opposite of that, he's saying, don't be deceived. Right? Don't be deceived. Right? So we see that, when we read earlier that the Holy Spirit is the one, especially in the Holy Spirit class, we see that Holy Spirit is the one who, we look at God himself, when we see that one of the characteristics is that he's omniscient, he's all-knowing. It's nothing that is hidden. There's nothing that he does not know. Okay. Everything that you see, how does everything work? He knows it already. And the Holy Spirit, we see typically anointing or giving that Bezalel the skill and ability for workmanship, right, of precious stones and carvings and, you know, so artistic skill the Holy Spirit is giving. And then another place we see, you know, agriculture, when it comes to things that are grown and things that are harvested and how it should be, you know, it says that this also comes from God. This also comes from God. So the thing is that in Him is all knowledge. In Him is all wisdom. And there's no reason to doubt that and say, okay, maybe matters that are spiritual, well, I can go to God, or, you know, other things that, you know, I don't have to. Well, the thing is, see, there is definitely, you know, we go to college or university or, you know, to learn some things that are, you know, specific, pick up some skills and all that. Nothing, you know, there's absolutely nothing wrong, and we need to do that. We need to be trained, etc. But we need to understand that that the Lord, He knows, He is omniscient, that in Him resides all wisdom and all knowledge. Okay, I was just looking for this scripture, you know, Isaiah 28, verses 23 to 29, right? Isaiah 23 to 29. So it talks about how the plowman, does he keep plowing all day to sow? Does he keep turning his soil, breaking his clods, etc.? It talks about wheat, it talks about barley and, you know, cumin and all that. And then finally it says, you know, verse 28 of Isaiah 28, it says, bread flour must be ground, therefore he does not thresh it forever, break it with his cartwheel, or crush it with his horsemen. This also comes from the Lord of hosts, who is wonderful in counsel and excellent in guidance. Okay, so this also comes from the Lord of hosts. So Paul, yeah, mentioning that, lest anyone should deceive you otherwise, right? So what is falsely called as knowledge and philosophy and wisdom, lest anyone cheat you on that, okay? So don't be deceived. Now, for though I am absent in the flesh, yet I am with you in spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and steadfastness of your faith in Christ. So verse 6 is saying, as you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in Him. You know, how did you receive? By faith. How did you receive? Wholeheartedly. How did you, you know, receive Christ? You know, and the work of the Spirit, your hearts were open to it. We see in Galatians the same thing. He's actually rebuking them for the fact that they were entertaining other teaching, which was drawing them back to the law. And it was not according to faith, and it was according to works and the law. So he was actually warning them. He's saying, you know, how did you receive the Spirit? Was it through works? Was it through faith? Did you not believe and did you not receive? How do these, you know, the signs and the miracles, you know, how do these happen? Was it because of faith or was it because of the working of the law? In a similar manner, he's saying, you know, as you have received Christ, you know, in the manner in which you walk in Him, there's no need to, you know, make certain departures. Continue to walk in Him. Continue to live in Him, right? So walk in Him. May your lifestyle and be like this. Rooted and built up. Rooted and built up. So rooted meaning striking roots. You know, the word used there, rizzo, meaning how roots would go and strike the ground and go inside and give that stability for the plant and be a source of, you know, even nourishment and water and everything for the plant. So saying that you do that, like rooted and built up, okay, meaning build upon, right? So build upon that foundation, be rooted, be established in the faith, okay? Be established in the faith. So rooted, built up, established in the faith. Be strong, be unmovable, stabilized in the faith. Okay, so let no one deceive you, or let no one tell you otherwise through their persuasive words, but you be rooted, you be built up, or which means you continue to grow, and you be established, right? You be established in the faith. Okay, let me just move the notes. Yeah. As you have been taught, and abounding in it with thanksgiving. Okay, so abounding in it, increasing, abounding, going from strength to strength, going from, you know, ever increasing. So let it be in excess, right? So how you have been taught to be rooted, to be built up, to be established, you know, you abound in it with thanksgiving, right? We have a grateful heart, have a grateful, actually that word means grateful language, right? So let there be giving of thanks, even as you continue to grow, you know. So so what happens is, like, giving of thanks, it literally grounds us, keeps us humble, and we are grounded, you know. We're not puffed up, we don't become proud, because we are giving thanks for each and everything. We're giving thanks to God. You know that it's not us, you know that it's not because of anything that we have done, and we have received it from Him. All we are doing is receiving by faith. All we are doing is posturing ourselves to receive from Him. Okay, so abounding in it with thanksgiving. Okay, so let's look at the verses after that. So he's saying, you know, as you have received Christ, walk in Him, abounding in it with thanksgiving. Verse 8 is, again, you know, he's explaining about the deception with persuasive words. Verse 4, so he's saying, beware, you know, again, he's cautioning, be alert, beware lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit, according to the tradition of man, according to the basic principles of the world, and not according to Christ. Okay, so this is applicable for each of us, even today. You know, philosophy is just love of wisdom, right? So it's love of wisdom. It's learning new things, right? But the thing is, how can anyone cheat you with philosophy? How can anyone deceive you with, you know, philosophy? So when that replaces our knowledge in Christ, or when that becomes the worldview through which you're going to see the world. Okay, so let's say because of knowledge, because of this wisdom and learning, and there are, you know, several different worldviews, and then, you know, there is this whole train of thought that there are no moral absolutes. Moral absolutes means there's no absolute right or wrong, that everything is relative. And so, you know, what is happening? You know, something is being uprooted here. What is being uprooted? That God, that goodness from God, that He is the reference point for us to know what is good and know what is evil. You know, that His word reflects His character, and His word reflects His nature, and we see that there is no darkness in Him at all, and therefore, you know, we know that good, what is good, what is true, and He is the truth. So all this, if it's going to change because of philosophy, you know, philosophy by itself is, it's fine, but then if you're going to be cheated through philosophy, then Paul is alerting us to that, right? So the word used there is to, you know, to seduce and to take away. Okay, to take away your goods, right? So that's the picture we have, to take away your goods, to kind of seduce, and to make you dull and to take away your goods and to even take you away captive, right? So, well, that is the danger of not being grounded in truth while considering all the other things, you know. So saying that you be careful, let anyone cheat you, and through philosophy and empty deceit, meaning it's empty, it's vain, it's not useful, and it's plain deceit, right? It's deceitfulness, it's delusion, it's just to cheat, right? So what does it do, you know, philosophy and this kind of a vain deceit? It is according to the tradition of man. So which means that there are some traditions which are not in line, not according to, or not in line with godliness, right? Practices, traditions, maybe even certain cultures, which you know, customs, which are not in line with God's word, okay, which are not truth itself. So if these things take the place of truth or replace the truth that we are called to live by, then we are deceiving ourselves or giving in to deception. Okay, so it's according to the tradition of man and according to the basic principles of the world, right, and not according to Christ. Okay, so it's according to the tradition of man, it's according to the basic principles of the world, and it is not according to Christ, which means that it's not according to the truth itself. So it might have a form of knowledge or intellectualism, but at the end, it tries to exalt itself above the knowledge of Christ. Okay, so he's warning, and he's saying that, and this is what is creating a conflict in him. He knows that there are such people who are teaching. He knows that there are people. He has not actually, you know, seen this church, visited them, but he has obviously taught them from a distance through, you know, through others. Yes, who has come and ministered. So he's saying, you know, you be rooted, built up in Christ. So that way you will stand, you will go with the truth. Then you will not be led away. You will not be led astray from the truth. Okay. So let's look at verse 9. For in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Okay. So he's repeating that. He's reiterating what he said already in chapter 1, right? So we saw in, I'm just trying to see that verse. Yeah, chapter 1 and verse 19. For it pleased the Father that in him, again referring to Christ, that all the fullness should dwell, right? So here, again, it's not just part or a percentage, or like we're not saying like one-third Christ, you know, one-third God, one-third, you know, the Father, one-third the Holy Spirit. It's not saying that. He's saying that, you know, for in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, okay? And you are complete in him, okay? Which is amazing. And you are complete in him. So the spiritual reality is this, right? Yes, in Christ dwells the fullness of the Godhead. And he's saying that you are complete in him, yet you've, you know, there's nothing left. And in what sense is he saying that? You know, for we know that we are, you know, going from strength to strength, from glory to glory, right? We are, and in fact, he is, you know, his whole ministry is to present every person mature in Christ, which means that people are maturing. Right? They are growing in maturity, growing in Christ-likeness. So they are born again, but they are growing in maturity. They are being transformed. So in what sense is he saying that you are complete? You know, as a new creation, as people who are born again, as people who have been justified, right? There's nothing more left to be done. Right? You are complete. And the word again used there is plero, which means full, like that merchant ship, full of goods. You know, you are complete in Him. In Christ, we are complete. And who is the head of all principality and power? Okay, so you are complete in Christ, and He's the head of all principality and power. So in Christ dwells all the fullness of the Godhead. In Christ, Christ is the head of all principality and power. So there's nothing that is, you know, that He is subservient to, that He is all powerful. And because you are in Him, because you are in Christ, you are, you know, scripture talks about how we are one spirit with Him, that He's the vine, we are the branches, we are connected. The life of God, the flows, the very life, the Zoe God kind of life flows in, which flows in Him, flows in us. Okay. So that's the spiritual reality. So there's nothing more to be done in us, right? And that's the spiritual reality. And of course, our minds will be renewed and our lives will be transformed, and we are being changed from glory to glory. And there's a lot that happens in our in the realm of our soul, right? In the realm of our soul, a lot that is happening. But in the spirit, we are complete. Okay, who is the head of all principality and power? Okay, so let's look at verse 11. In Him, you were also circumcised with a circumcision made without hands, by putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ, buried with Him in baptism, in which you also were raised with Him through faith in the working of God, who raised Him from the dead. And you, being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, He has made alive together with Him, having forgiven you all trespasses, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, and He has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross, having disarmed principalities and powers, He made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. Okay. So verses 11 to 15, he's talking about something that has already happened, something that has happened in the past, right? Because of the cross. He's referring to the work, Christ's work on the cross, right? So, but first of all, he's talking about the fact that you were circumcised, but with this circumcision made without hands. Now, it was not a natural, physical circumcision. Right, and by putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. Okay. So the circumcision was actually a symbolic thing which the Jews indulge in. Now he's saying you were circumcised with the circumcision made without hands. So it was not a physical act. So what kind of an act was it? What did it result in? What is he referring to? He's referring to the fact that the body of the sins of the flesh being removed, right, by the circumcision of Christ. Verse 12, buried with Him in baptism, in which you were also raised with Him through faith in the working of God, who raised Him from the dead. So when He was buried, we were buried. Okay. We can identify with that. So when He was buried, we were buried. And when He was raised, and we were raised for with Him, we were also raised with Him. And through faith in the working of God, who raised Him from the dead. So when He was buried, we were buried. When He was raised, we were also raised. And he's talking about the work that happened in us, right? The work of redemption, the work of salvation that happened in us. And so he's saying, through faith in the working of God, through faith in this mighty working of God, in this resurrection power that worked and raised Christ from the dead. Okay. So you put your faith in that, what happened? You've put your faith in an event. You put your faith in God who did this, and that resulted in change in you. That resulted in the fact that this circumcision made without hands in you. Right? And what is this? It's referring to the removal of the sins of the flesh, right? And this is what happened. Verse 13, and you being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh. Now he's talking about the old man. He's talking about the old you and old me. So, saying that, and you being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he has made alive together. Okay, so we were dead in our trespasses, right? We were dead in our sins. We were not alive to God, right? We were not alive to God. We were not responding to God. We were dead in our trespasses to the things of God. Okay, we were alive to sin. We were alive to righteousness, but we were dead in our trespasses, right? So he's saying that he has made you who are in this condition, who were in the uncircumcision of your flesh and were dead in your trespasses. What has he done? He has made alive together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. So this is what happened. He made you alive together with him. We see a similar thing in Ephesians chapter 2 as well, right? Ephesians 2, verse 1, and you he made alive who were dead in trespasses and sins. Right. So you who are dead in trespasses and sins, he has made alive. Okay. And alive together with it. And the old English use there is quickened together. Okay, quickened together. And the word is used for a spiritual quickening. Like we were quickened together, made alive together. And if time is used, it's used for that kind of a spiritual quickening. Like Ephesians, we see the same thing. We've made alive, and here also in Colossians, we see that. Right. So we were made alive together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. So having forgiven, meaning it's something that he has already done. Okay. Now, all this came into being when we put our faith in the working of God. Okay, so it's not automatic. We need to understand that. But all this was set in motion and it came into being. It became a reality in our lives when we put our faith in the working of God. When we put our faith in what he has done. And all this came into being. So here he's saying that, he is having forgiven your trespasses, having forgiven you all trespasses. Okay, so there's nothing that is left unforgiven because he removed the body of sins. Okay, so having forgiven you all trespasses. Verse 14, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us. So everything that we owed God, everything that was required of us, everything that legally we were actually supposed to face the consequences of, right, because of the sin, because of sin nature, right, it was wiped away. So he's saying, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, and he has taken it out of the way, how? Having nailed it to the cross. Something beautiful. So he's just, just explaining this mystery, which he's talking about in chapter 1, this mystery of which he was a steward, the mystery of the glory of Christ in us, the hope of glory, the mystery which was now made known to the saints. He's just going to great detail and talking about what was done. So he's saying, you know, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, you know, this was needed. This was the right place to go. This was your destination, right? Which was away from God, away from Christ. This is where eternal damnation would take you. This is what the sins would take you to eternal damnation. But he took it out of the way. He has taken it out of the way, having wiped it out, having nailed it to the cross. So everything is referring to what happened on the cross. Okay, having nailed it to the cross. Verse 15, having disarmed. Okay, so having nailed, having forgiven. Now here he's saying having nailed or having disarmed, all principalities. Okay, so he's saying that, and the word again used there in the Old English, having spoiled, which means, you know, having taken out, having captured, having removed the spoils, right? In what was maybe the powers of darkness caring about, saying, you know, it was their spoil or it was their trophy, having removed it, having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them. Okay, so he's talking about principalities, he's talking about powers, and we know that these are, you know, different hierarchies in the spiritual realm. We read about that in Ephesians 6, right? Also, where he's talking about, you know, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness of the age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. So we see this kind of a hierarchy being mentioned there. And so he's referring to that. And he's saying that having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them. Okay, which means that he made a show of them. He made a public spectacle of them. He made an exhibit of them, exhibit of their defeat. Okay, so there's one thing to have a quiet defeat and put things out of the way, but it's a public spectacle for everyone to see. You know, when it's a public spectacle, it's in full view. It's something that no one can miss. So he made a public spectacle of this disarming of principalities and powers. And he's saying, triumphing over them in it. Okay, triumphing over them in it, being victorious over them in the what he did on the cross. Okay, is talking about the cross, right? It's talking about having nailed it to the cross, and it's everything is happening around the cross and what happened because of, when you say cross, we're talking about the physical death. We're talking about what he carried and what was destroyed, right? So he disarmed principalities and powers. He made a public spectacle. He made an exhibit of them. He made a, you know, something that people could see, public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in this work of the cross, right? Triumphing over them in it. Okay. So, he's going on to talk about some important things here. The reason, you know, he shared all this. First of all, he's talking about, let no one deceive you through philosophy and empty deceit. Okay, so let no one do that, because in Christ dwells all the knowledge, all wisdom, richly. Right, so that hidden treasures. Sorry, I'm just looking for that phrase. Hidden treasures, hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. So in him, and he also talks about how in him there's a fullness of the Godhead dwells bodily. So this is who Christ is. Okay, so don't let anyone deceive you out of deceive you with philosophy and empty deceit and so on. Okay, so here he's talking about this. You know, this is what Christ did on the cross, right? You were forgiven of all trespasses, and you have been washed, and you have been made alive. You have been forgiven, and he has disarmed the principalities and powers, etc. right? He's wiped out. He has taken away everything that was against us, everything that was incriminating us, everything that was pointing us to the fact that we should spend an eternity away from him. You know, all those legal requirements or legal clause, he has removed it, having nailed it to the cross. So let no one judge you in food or drink, or regarding a festival or a new moon or Sabbaths, which are a shadow of things to come, but the substance is of Christ. Let no one cheat you of your reward, taking delight in false humility and worship of angels, intruding into those things which he has not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind, and not holding fast to the head, from whom all the body, nourished and knit together by joints and ligaments, grows into the increase that is from God. Therefore, if you died with Christ from the basic principles of the world, why, as though living in the world, do you subject yourselves to regulations? Do not touch, do not taste, do not handle, which all concern things which perish with the using, according to the commandments and doctrines of men. These things indeed have an appearance of wisdom, of self-imposed religion, false humility, and neglect of the body, but are of no value against the indulgence of the flesh. Okay. So he makes this very clear. So he's referring to, again, from this we see that some of the teachings, probably some of the persuasions that were happening during that time in the church there, some of those things which are happening. So maybe there was a drawing back to, people were drawing, or teaching and saying that you need to keep the law, right? You need to be circumcised. So he's, you know, earlier on he's saying, you know, you are actually circumcised. This is what circumcision is. You are circumcised with circumcision, not made with hands, by putting away the body of the sins of the flesh. So you're already, you know, circumcised. And this is what it is, right? So people were, probably there was again a teaching of going back to the law. Okay, yes, you are saved, but you need to do this. You need to keep this. You need to keep the feast. You need to keep the, you know, these things. And on certain days, you need to eat this. On certain days, you cannot eat this, you know. So he's talking about all that, all those restrictions, and do not touch, do not taste, do not handle. Okay, all the ritual purifications and everything. And he's saying, you know, this all concern things which perish with the using. These are material things. These are physical things that, you know, this will perish, or this will come to an end with the using. But know that the substance is of Christ. There is a shadow. You know, these are point to certain, you know, spiritual truths. But know that the substance is of Christ. The substance is of Christ, right? So he's mentioning all this. Okay. So specifically, right, certain things. Let no one judge you in food or in drink, or regarding a festival or a new moon or Sabbaths. Okay. So which they probably were being taught. So he's saying, okay, no one needs to judge you or say what you are doing is wrong in these areas, in these matters, right? Because you've been set free from that. Now, all this, these festivals and Sabbaths, they are a shadow of things to come. But the substance is of Christ. Okay. The substance is of Christ in the sense, you know, the ceremonial laws, some of the feasts and everything, it has significance. It is pointing to certain truths, but the substance, you have already experienced, you know, the reality is Christ himself. Okay, so we'll stop here, verse 17, and then we'll continue on from next class onwards, right? Okay, thank you. God bless you. Yeah, sure, Dave. Yes, I'll post the notes in the classroom. Thank you. Thank you for reminding.